So I'm going to base my word today on Romans 12, 1 to 2, which says this: Therefore I urge you, brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. This is your true and proper worship. And we experienced that this morning, isn't it? Willing worship to God. Do not be conformed to the patterns of the world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you will be able to test and approve what God's will is, His good, pleasing, and perfect will. Amen. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for your word. It is a lamp to our feet. And I want to pray, God, that for my brothers and sisters here, Lord Jesus, that you will enable me by the power of your Spirit and your presence, Lord, to share this word out of what you've given me in Jesus' name. Now, you know, the remarkable thing about the Bible is that, for those who are unfamiliar with it, is that it makes a tall claim that it is the inspired word of God. And although it's been written by different people, it has been held together, strung together by the Spirit. It is God breathed, as it says. All of it, however, points to one person. His name is Jesus. Say Jesus would be loudly, because it'll be all clear. His name is
Jesus.
That's right. That is the one all of the Bible points towards. Now, he came down here because God saw suffering mankind and said something needs to be done. Now, the root of all suffering is sin. We know that. It's elementary, but it's important to remind ourselves. Self-inflicted or even inherited, there are consequences to what we do. Life is not just aimless. And so this verse from Exodus, I'm going to quote right now. It says this: So you shall not make for yourself an image in the form of anything in heaven above, on the earth beneath, or in the waters below. You shall not bow down to them or worship them, for I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God, punishing the sins of the children for the sins of the parents to the third and fourth generation of those who hate me, but showing love to 1,000 generations of those who love me and keep my commands. There's a promise and a warning in that. Clearly, one can see that there are generational blessings and curses that come our way. But Jesus comes and changes all that. We live in a country where you pray the law of karma, cause and effect, is carried to the extreme, as we know. Or kismat is another word that comes. This is my fortune. Both these words has elements of fatalism inside it. That means, this is my lot, I've got to live with it. But our lot, those who believe in Jesus, and if you're sitting down here and you are going through life with this sense of hopelessness, then this is the day, once again, for you to be reminded that Jesus Christ came to change everyone's karma, to change it and give hope, and to bring in life. We no longer are enslaved to suffer the bad consequences of our sins here on earth and in the life to come. All we have to do is what? Is do nothing. All we have to do is believe. And as we believe, in 5 minutes, or not even 5 minutes, 5 seconds, stacks of sin, which may be accumulated, stacks of curses can be broken in the name of Jesus. That's how powerful it is. Okay? I love the songs that we sang this morning. All of them speak about how God transforms our brokenness and makes us whole. And so therefore, on the 8th of August, I remember I had to go through this process, and as I went through it, I came out a new man. Now, this passage has four basic points. It starts by saying, in view of God's mercy. See, the starting point of anything is important, because where you start from determines where you're going to end up. Anything in life. You can start by saying, scientific start. Why? Show me cause and effect. Or you can start by saying, in the beginning. In the beginning, you start from Genesis, and then you see what happens after that. You have a person like Moses, who encounters God in a burning bush. Can you imagine how that changes his whole belief system and his way of thinking? Because he's influenced by an encounter with God. So it all starts by encountering the God of mercy, who becomes the God of grace. And if you are sitting down here and you have not really had that encounter, and I'm not talking about it necessarily being dramatic. It can be very simple. Sometimes people just hear a voice. Or it can be very dramatic, as in my case, where God met with me very powerfully. But it starts there. So the first thing Paul knows, and if you look at the book of Romans, that wonderful thesis on the gospel, saying the talks begins by the depravity of man, and about the law, God sending in the law, and then how the law was replaced by grace through faith in Jesus Christ. So much so that the gospel provokes us in Romans chapter 5 to say, hey, can I go on sinning? I no longer have the law. And then, of course, he adds the caution, by no means. And so, by the time you reach chapter 12, it is established that we are all recipients of his mercy. If you reach there and you believe what it's saying, that we are all under mercy. But then he says this, in view of God's mercy. So we are starting with that, in view of God's mercy. We have received the mercy. What do? Offer our bodies as a living, as a holy sacrifice, of your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing unto God. That means living a life that is separated unto God, totally. Now, in truth, in reality, there can sometimes be a contamination, isn't it? When we are born again, our spirits become alive. Our sin nature is totally changed. But our minds have yet to be renewed. And our minds need to come into what they're talking about here. And so he says, Paul says, do not be conformed to the patterns of this world. The patterns of this world are a mindset. We all have the patterns of the world, or we are subject to the patterns of this world at some stage or the other. And then he says, and then you'll be able to discern his good, perfect, and pleasing will. So I'm going to focus on the patterns of the mind, because the patterns of the world are the patterns of the mind, because he says, be transformed, do not conform to this, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. So the patterns of the mind is what he's talking about. What are these patterns and how are they formed? How can we be set free from bad or evil patterns, or even, I dare say, good but ungodly patterns? There are bad patterns and good patterns. Both fall in one category. In Isaiah 64:6, it says, all our righteous acts are like filthy rags. So even that we bring before the Lord. Remember, we are on a journey this morning to know and to discern the good, pleasing, and perfect will. Where does it begin? In Psalm 139, verse 13 and 14, it says this, for you created my inmost being. Now, I want you to imagine, as I'm reading these verses, you in your mother's womb. Every one of us was in a womb at some stage. Shut your eyes right now. Imagine this. You created my inmost being. So God created you while you were there. You knit me together in my mother's womb. God knitting you together. I praise you because I'm fearfully and wonderfully made. Your works are wonderful. I know that full well. Tell the person next to you, you are wonderfully made. You're wonderfully made. We are all wonderfully made. See, Psalm 139 speaks of God's sovereign hand upon every human being. That you, the fact that you're alive and yet you're here, there's because God's sovereign hand has been upon you. You know, God wanted you to be here on earth, which is why abortions is such an abomination. It goes against the will of God. But I'm digressing. Let me get back to what I want to say. New life begins, however. So when do these patterns begin? New life begins at conception, not birth, isn't it? And I want to show you the video I had, unfortunately, did not reproduce on my sticks. I'm going to show you a very compromised one and make a few comments. Can we have the video, please? Now just watch the extent of life. Okay, jogging in the womb. There's life, right? Thank you. Okay? Playing tennis, holding something in the hand. Snowboard. Already in the womb is life. Beginning to be a chatterbox in the womb. Getting depressed in the womb, weeping, crying, the patterns being formed. Okay, aggression. Okay, we stopped there. Thank you. Thank you. So you can see that the patterns begin to get formed in the womb. That's how early our patterns. And I want to say that actually it goes even further back. Where does it go back? We are products of our parents' DNA. So who they are is reproduced inside us. It is self-evident that as we grow, we resemble our parents, either predominantly with one or the other or a mixture of the two, isn't it? And I just like you to take a little look at this video, this photograph, and see three generations. Here are three generations. In our church, they would all said, ah, they recognize some of them. You don't recognize them. Well, the guy on the chair is yours truly at that age, all right? And similar age, the one at the top is my son, and the one below is my grandson. Don't we resemble one another at that age, right? So you can see that there are these external, look, we look alike. And so you can also see, it's common, we find this, isn't it? But what we do not see is that we also inherit certain character traits, certain ways of thinking, and these become part of us. So we inherit some of our patterns from our background, good patterns and bad patterns. And often our state of being is determined by the state of our parents. You know, I know someone who was sharing with me how, you know, in the course of counseling, he was talking about himself feeling very depressed, often looking at life negatively, always feeling critical about things or rejection. And he said he suddenly thought about it, and as we asked the question about this, said that, you know, he was born 9 years after his last sibling when his parents were older. So the shock of the news, as he got that news, affected him. Because they must have said, oh no, not a child right now. What are they doing? They're passing on a pattern of rejection onto their child. Now, in this church, I'm sure this is thought a lot, and it's known, especially those who have done inner healing. By the way, how many of you have done inner healing here? You've been to the inner healing. So quite a few have not yet done it. Can I just encourage you to think about what I'm saying and attend it, perhaps the next one. It's up to you. So in other words, he felt that his lifestyle, even at the age of 40, is one of constantly looking at the world as rejecting him. You know, what happens to us is either we respond either in conformity, often compliant, or the opposite. We respond in rebellion to the patterns that we encounter. You know, you can go on and on, addictions, you find sometimes what is passed on from one generation to another can be ingrained in who we are. Now, by the way, don't get too troubled by going and searching. But if you get to know that this is what happened at the time of your conception, you know, it works amazingly. Lynn and I did a parenting workshop, and as we were talking to someone, this lady came, and we had done this sort of teaching. She came and said, you know, I've come here for the sake of my son, because he's a bit naughty. I've got 4 children, and the first one is the girl, and she's like this, and the second one is a girl, but she's a tomboy. And the third one is my boy. And she said, huh? What happened? She said, you know, I suddenly realized When the second one, when the second one was born, I was disappointed. I wanted a boy. I was expecting a boy. So when she said she's like a tomboy, she then realized, oh, it has been conveyed somewhere that, hey, this is what I wanted. So what happens, it becomes an identity problem for this person concerned. Our sexuality is wrapped up in our identity, isn't it? If you're a man, you're a man, that's your identity. If you're a woman, you're a woman, that's your identity. But today you notice the confusion that is taking place all over the place. Because identity is getting confused. So you're rejecting what God has made you and trying to be someone else because you want to please, subconsciously or consciously, the person who is closest to you, namely your parents. You can inherit kindness and gentleness, hospitality, things of this kind you can inherit from your parents. They're referred to as patterns of the world. That's what you inherit. They aren't coming from the freedom of who God has made us, or the freedom that we have in Christ, referred to in Galatians chapter 5. Mind you, God will use our background. God will use our background and our DNA to shape us into a unique new person as we go along and encounter Christ. Secondly, our patterns are formed by the interplay of our circumstances upon us. They are formed primarily between the ages of 0 to 6 or beyond. So those patterns begin to get formed. By the way, how we are brought up in our initial years are very important. In our pastoral ministry, and particularly with marriage, whether it's Christians or people of other faiths, Lynn and I rarely deal with circumstances as they are today. We're getting into often arguments, we're getting angry with each other, we're doing that. We don't touch that. We ask the question, what was your childhood like? Therein lies the solution. What was it like, your relationship with your dad like? What was your relationship with your mind like? And I want to say, not 98%, 99% of the time, the solution lies in tackling that root. Elementary inner healing stuff. But it's amazing how revelatory this ministry is and what it is in terms of the patterns of the mind, because therein patterns are formed. That's why we say in our ministry, the Abrahamic blessings for a couple can be sorted out that way. We did this once with a wife who flew down from Dubai to see us with her husband. You know, her husband is very violent. And so we got down to the understanding. He had a violent father. And said, it's passed off. Now we dealt with it as we prayed. Now he's a person of other faiths. So powerful is this truth that you get to the root of it. That after some months, we got back in touch with that lady. And she said, you know something? He has stopped being violent. You see the power of what I'm talking about? Because that was his pattern. That was the only pattern he knew. And once he began to see the truth sets him free. How much more when you know Jesus Christ? Amen. All these forms patterns of the world. But the issue is, how do we break free? And I want to submit a few points to you on how do we break free. Number one, be willing to accept God's mercy by admitting that you need help. As I'm talking, maybe your patterns are not as severe as this. But like I said, when you're born again, you get a new nature. The old is gone, the new has come. But our minds still need to be renewed. And you're finding there are certain patterns in your life that are not particularly life-giving. Recognize them and say, God, I need your mercy afresh. I need your mercy for what I'm talking about right now. In Romans 12:1, it says, therefore, my brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy, offer your bodies as a living sacrifice. In other words, we're coming to God for mercy, which is found at the cross. The cross deals with our past, and the resurrection deals with our present and the future. That is the power. We are anchored in a wonderful present and a very powerful assurance of the future. See, 1 Peter 1:18, 19 says this, for you know that it is not with perishable things, such as silver or gold, that you were redeemed, but from the empty way of life handed down to you from your ancestors. So we are handed an empty way of life by our ancestors. But with the precious blood of Christ, a lamb without blemish or defect, Jesus coming to deliver us from empty patterns of our lives. That is wonderful, isn't it? So we are morphed into a new pattern in Christ. We become products of the cross, not our past. We live in the patterns of love and acceptance. Oftentimes, in Philippians 2:12, he says, "Work out your salvation with fear and trembling, for God is at work in you to will and to act according to his good purpose." I was doing a workshop on emotional intelligence in a company. These are all secular people, mind you. And at the end of that session, you know, in emotional intelligence, one of the things you need to know is become self-aware. What is happening inside you? And once you're aware and you're conscious, then you accordingly handle your response. You can determine your responses up to a point. So one of the guys there said, "Excuse me, sir, you're asking us to do something from who you're telling us, don't be who you are, be something else. How do we move from who we are to who we should be?" So I looked and said, here is my opportunity. I said, "You know, you've asked me a very important question. And the only way I can answer it is to tell you what happened to my life." So I got a chance in a secular setting to tell them what happened to my life. In short, how I had these useless, futile patterns in my life. And when I finished talking, I finished the session. Four guys came, according to their tradition, and came to touch my feet. And I had to tell them, no, please, don't do this. Okay? Why are they doing this? Because I believe you and I have gold inside us that the world is waiting to hear. Do you follow what I'm saying? So, you know, the wonderful programs are being announced in Adonai Church. What an opportunity. What a great thing for you guys to, not everyone can be involved in ministry directly, unless you feel a calling to it, but you can certainly say, we have the answer. And then, one of the guys comes up to me and says, "Sir, excuse me, why is it that I feel like crying when I see a senior manager, when I'm talking to him? I feel like crying." And then as he's talking to me, he's saying, I said, "How was your relationship with your father?" He said, "I had a wonderful relationship with my father." I said, "Perhaps you're seeing your father in the manager." In the manager. To which he says, "Sir, see, it's happening again. Now it's happening." And he begins to weep. And he comes into my arms and starts weeping. Where is that taking place? In a corporate training room full of people. And he's saying he wants to be set free from something. He does not know what. You see, these patterns run deep in people's lives. And we must be the people who understand God's word and then puts it into practice. So, how do we move from where we are to where we should be is the question, isn't it? Second thing is, recognize the patterns in your own mind. As I'm talking, identify patterns that you, recognize patterns that you yourself may have. Someone was telling me that whenever he's tired and troubled about something, his pattern is to go to sexual thoughts and to pornography. In through the ministry, we've realized boys and girls are finding comfort in that, creating patterns that are very difficult to break. Pornography is taking place in the secret place of the mind. And so, we got to be careful. What is your pattern? Is that your pattern? It is so sinister that I'm told worship leaders in certain places would be having a secret pattern of going to pornography because that is their comfort place. I'm not talking about this church, other places. But all of us have these patterns. I catch myself often and say, ah, this is my pattern. The moment you put your head down on your pillow, what are the patterns that you've created? There can be patterns of addictions of different kinds, including things like food and chocolates, right? I see that in myself often. Ah, can't help myself. Kit Kat? I have a weakness for Kit Kat. Don't give them to me now, okay? Weakness for it. It's a pattern. There could be patterns of rejection. You see everyone rejecting you. That's a pattern. Where was it created? In your mother's womb? If you know? Or later on? In school, etc.? Patterns of depression. You're getting up every morning with depression. It's a pattern that's been created. Self-centeredness. You can't think of other people. You're only thinking of yourself all the time. Negative pessimism. I had this interesting encounter with a guy who was working with me, and I said, hey, I need to have some lunch. So he says, okay. I said, can we have lunch? He said, okay, I'll try and order it. So he tries, takes his phone, he tries to order it, and then he comes back to me, he says, you know, they want an order of 500 rupees only, otherwise they won't send it. So why don't we buy two? I said, well, I don't have two. So I said, is there any solution? He says, no. I said, well, you got your bike? He said, no, I don't have my bike. I said, any other solution? He says, no, there's no solution. I said, okay, then I won't have lunch. He said, okay, bye. He went off. I got miffed, by the way. I didn't have lunch that day. Because his mind couldn't come to the point of being created. So some of us can be in such a groove that we're stuck. The mind is perpetually pessimistic. It cannot think positively. Or you could have patterns of anger. Anger coming up almost explicitly, inexplicitly. Press a button and you get angry. There are moments when you get angry. And there are patterns against certain people or how you respond to them. That is not helpful. There can be patterns of fears. You're just receiving the news in the newspaper and you're getting into fears. His perfect love casts out all fear. Remember, we've been set free by Jesus on the cross, yet the patterns may continue. Sometimes good patterns can become dead works because they aren't rooted in Christ or coming out of the now life in Christ. If you're not doing something because you love doing it, it becomes boring and terrible, isn't it? My third point is this. Live in the freedom that there is in Christ. Galatians 5:1-2 says, it is for freedom that Christ has set you free. That's a lovely, lovely verse. Because it's saying, you know, become almost slaves to freedom. That we people can't help but be free at all times. That really is a person who is not getting caught up inside you by the world outside. Your reference point is Christ only all the time. You're living in the presence. Stand firm then, and do not let anyone be burdened again. Let yourselves be burdened again by the yoke of slavery. You know, I remember when I was a new Christian, the guy comes into my office, and he was my advertising manager, and I said, hey, Naeem, give me a fag, yeah? See, he gives me this king. In those days, you had the king's filtered, Will's King filtered. So I take this fag, light it. As I'm lighting it, suddenly my lungs got choked. And I put it off and said, I don't want to taste it again. You may say I got delivered of smoking. Actually, I got delivered from the need to impress other people, which was necessary because I wanted acceptance. Why do we get into some habits? Out of needing for peer group acceptance, we get into certain habits. And before long, they become addictions. So watch out for that. Remember, it all starts in the mind. Replace them with God's pattern found by faith in His Word. In Romans 8:6, it says, the mind governed by the flesh is death, but the mind governed by the Spirit is life and peace. You know, it's all operating in the mind. In 2002, we went through a very traumatic experience in my life as a leader. I stepped down from leadership because I needed to sort out certain things. But through that process, I became extremely embittered. I was angry against specific people. And I used to go into, when I went into my bath, to have my bath, that's where I used to work out my anger. And so much so that one day I came out and Lynn said, what's the matter with you? Do you know I can hear you outside? That means I was talking to someone with anger there. And so I said, oh, this is getting bad. So I decided what I'm going to do inside. When I get into the bathroom, I'm going to worship God. And when I first started, it required an effort. But what was I doing? I was renewing my mind. I was renewing my pattern. At first, it requires a tremendous effort because my mind was easily going back. Even when you're singing a song of worship, you can get angry thoughts. Anyone can identify with me? What holy people in this church, man. Come on, don't fool me. You can already start thinking of your lunch right now, isn't it? These are the thoughts going in your mind. See, what's for lunch? Where am I going out for lunch? Those are thoughts, the patterns, because the stomach has got a pattern, right? So the patterns. But if you live out of the life of Christ, so I suddenly realized, as I diligently put that into practice, now when I go into the bathroom, I automatically start worshiping God. It's become a new pattern. It's become a pattern of life. It's life-giving. So all of us can do that. You know, in Philippians chapter 4, verse 8, Paul is talking about anxiety. And he gives us a wonderful tool on how to avoid anxiety. 4:8. Finally, brothers, you know, that portion which says, do not be anxious for anything, but in all things by prayer and petition with thanksgiving, make your request known to God. But he still knows something else is needed. What is it? Finally, brothers, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is commendable. And he goes, he gives you some more. And he says, think about such things. Paul understands how the mind of a Christian works. You think about something. That means you have to choose. The power of choice lies with us. And Jesus enables us to do that. Okay? Lastly, I want to say, live from an inner awareness. Life is continually, live in the continual life flow of the Spirit, not the patterns. As you live in the life of the Spirit, something happens. Now it says, it takes 23 days to establish a new pattern. Why 23 days? Ask the psychologists. I don't know. But try it out. Try out a new pattern of your own. One guy was saying, you know, he met a pastor from our church. He said, I keep my mind afresh. He's a 70-year-old man. By doing something new all the time. For example, brushing my teeth with my left hand. It's a ridiculous thing to do. But the world knows something about the power of the mind. The Bible knows it. And so we want to see that we become a people who have the pattern of Christ inside us. And our minds are flowing. And therefore our lives and our actions are flowing out of the new pattern in Christ. The takeaway and the icing on the cake is this. Then you'll be able to discern His good, perfect, and pleasing will. This is a consequence of doing all that I'm saying earlier. So in closing, as I'm speaking, I am pretty sure you identified your patterns. Am I right? How many of you identified patterns of your own? You identified patterns as I'm speaking. Why don't you stand up? I'd like to speak to pray for you. That God will give you His patterns for your life. Why don't you stand up? Those who recognize patterns, whoo, quite a few. You recognize the patterns that you're living in. By the way, it's a good thing we can keep them secret, isn't it? Because some of them are embarrassing. What are those patterns in my own life? They can be very embarrassing. But God knows them. And God wants to set you free to live for Him, right? So I'm going to ask you to put your hands on your heads, on your minds, right? Nothing particularly significant, it's just a Spirit-filled move that I'm making. Right? Heavenly Father, as my dear and beloved friends and brothers and sisters have stood up to recognize their patterns, Lord, thank You that they have received God's mercy. And if anyone has not received God's mercy, let him receive it today, Lord Jesus. And I want to pray in Your precious name, Lord Jesus, that those patterns will be broken in the name of Jesus. That they will be conscious of them. They will apply the blood of the Lamb and the testimony of the Word to those patterns. And they will be broken in the name of Jesus. the name that is all powerful, to be set free, to live as free people, honoring their God. In Jesus' powerful and almighty name, I pray. And all God's people said, Amen. Thank you.